not going to play the tune to the order. We want to be able to announce things in between. So we're going to start right in the middle of what you see on your program with a tune called Who Can I Turn To? Are you ready? In case you don't, well, we got a tape problem here, just a second. In case you don't know, we're Jazz Band 1. Yeah. We're going to have to play awfully good to play better than those last two, aren't we?
Thank you.
See, this way, the old folks up here gets to rest in between the tune and we get to talk. You got a comedy routine? Okay, we're going to slow it down and do a tune for you now called Some Other Time.
Thank you.
The first time I met Tony Campisi, I lived in Houston, was directing a high school there in Spring Branch called Memorial. Tony taught some of my saxophone players. I used to go on Saturday nights and hear him at some of the local places. And I had always been an admirer of his because I had listened to the Stan Kenton recordings many, many times. During those days, if you were doing a high school jazz band, about the only good literature that you could get at that time was published by a group that the Stan Kenton people started, the Creative World Publications. They started summer camps for jazz band kids for the first time ever. I mean, we're talking about when I went to college, they wouldn't even allow a jazz band. And I went to conservative college, mind you, but it was the same many places. And when I was at Baylor, they started the very first jazz band Baylor ever had at that time. And some of us got together, you know, we had to rehearse after hours, etc. You couldn't find music, you had to beg, borrow, steal, whatever. And education was something that most jazz people tried to keep any traits that they had or tricks, they tried to keep them a secret. Well, people like Stan Kenton and Tony Campisi have changed jazz. They brought it to the public. They brought it to high school students. They've got people interested in it at a young age so that they have the opportunity to develop. And we owe a real tribute to people. I heard we were talking about Tony coming out, and one of our private teachers named Russell Brown was telling me he had taught at a college earlier. He's an older gentleman, just a wonderful, wonderful man. And was telling me that he had a good friend that had really impressed Stan Kenton, and he was going to go on the band with Stan Kenton until Stan Kenton found out that he was about to graduate from college and hadn't finished his degree. He would not let him play on the band until he finished.
It's really a pleasure to be here, and I'm glad that I found out that the jazz band meets at 7:40 in the morning. I found that out when I had rehearsals. I didn't know whether that was the earliest I'd ever been up or the latest I'd ever stayed up. So. But it was fun. I was glad to see that every morning these young people are here at 7:40 a.m. to play jazz. And it's a great thing. It was really, you know, kind of made me feel real good and warm inside that these young people are there. They're always here. So they really want to do it. And I'm pro-jazz, and I've played a lot of classical, and I'm for all the different music. Jazz is my favorite because it gives me a chance to create. And sometimes people get intimidated by jazz maybe a little bit because, you know, they see a guy or a person sitting next to them, you know, snapping their fingers, shaking their head, and they wonder, well, what am I supposed to be thinking? You know, but I'll tell you something. As, you know, we play tunes like Some Other Time, that's a Leonard Bernstein tune, you recognize the melody, then I go off this melody. And what I'm doing here is creating. It's original. It's happening on the spur of the moment. It's different every time. But believe me, give yourselves credit for something. Your imagination. Whatever it is I'm playing, you don't have to know anything special. No music at all. Whatever my music and my playing, what this band's music does to you, that's original. Whatever you're thinking about, what we are doing or I am doing, is just as original. So you all have something extra special in your minds. Whatever you're thinking, it's like nobody else, not like the person sitting next to you. So give yourself some credit when you do listen to jazz music. And, you know, you may not like what one guy does to you, it creates in your mind, so go listen to somebody else, henceforth equals taste. But I'm going to get off this pedestal and play. But thank you very much. I have an array of instruments here, the bass flute, and I run it through a digital delay, and I've gotten into some meditation music, helping insomniacs, cancer patients relieve pain through non-tension music. And this bass flute and this mechanical device, the electronic device, have helped me create that. I've been to the Hill Country Youth Ranch, some hospitals, and it paints pictures, and you know, I like to share it with you and see if it helps you relax and see what kind of pictures it paints for you.
Thank you.
Iowa with all the pig farmers, back in the backwoods there, Washington, Iowa. I mean, there was some places there that we'd see these herds of pigs and hogs just running. And the bus driver would just honk his horn while we get them. She couldn't pigs and hogs, just a scatter. I'm glad the farmers didn't catch us working off that meat, off those animals. We'd have been in trouble. So Stan said, we got to do something to pay tribute to the hogs of Iowa. And I said, well, okay, we'll come up with something. And we came up with this, and we started out playing this at the Great American Music Hall in San Francisco. Never went back there since, but here's one for the Hogs of Iowa.
Hey!
The other day, when Tony came out, he came out Wednesday morning, and we put all this stuff together for the first time. I told the kids that, you know, we had a, 2 weeks earlier, we had played for senior awards, which we played 36 tunes. And they weren't very long, but they still, it's a matter of putting them together, one rehearsal, playing them, and trying not to make any mistakes in the middle. So they had a feeling of exactly what it's like to be in a professional group, because most of the times when a professional musician shows up for a gig, there are no rehearsals. You sit down and the book's sitting in front of you, and you have to read it cold the first time. So they had that opportunity 2 weeks ago. The music you've heard this evening is music that we've been working on. This is our 10th rehearsal.
Yeah.
In 10 days, they worked up this much music. I think it's a real commitment by them and a tribute to them, because at this time of year, they have 1,000 things to do, 1,000 distractions, yet they love music, they love jazz, they wanted to play for you, and they worked this stuff up. So my hat's off to you. They still didn't believe me, though, when Tony came out that he was going, because two of the tunes, Return of the Diver and Cherokee, he had to sight read with us the day that we played. They said, oh, he really didn't do that. He's really not going to sight read. We handed him his music when he showed up. So he did. He did a great job. And so you're in for a treat now. It's an old standard, but done in a modern way, and it's entitled Cherokee. By the way, this is our last number. So. You've been a great audience. We love playing for you. And we hope we can finish with a bang here.
Put a hand for Mr. Dennis Hopkins.